Good evening, everybody. First of all, I thank the sponsors for giving me a chance. So today my talk is on probiotics and prebiotics. So by definition, what are probiotics? They are live. Probiotics are live microbial feed supplements that have a beneficial effect on the host by improving the intestinal microbial balance. So going back to the history, it was Yelly Metchnikoff, a Russian, who had used probiotics. Yelly Metchnikoff, way back in the early 20th century, he was a professor at Paris Institute in Paris. He observed that Bulgarians who drank milk fermented by lactic acid producing bacteria had long life. Lactic acid assists it lowers the gut pH and inhibits the growth of some pathogenic bacteria. Metchnikoff himself began drinking fermented milk, and soon the Parisian physicians also did likewise. So Henry Tisser at Pasteur Institute identified the bacteria common in the breastfed infants, namely the Bifidobacter. So lactobacillus acidophilus, when taken, it breaks down the lactose and allows lactose intolerant individuals to drink milk. So what happens in a newborn microbiota? It initially depends upon the mother's microbiota. The mode of the delivery of the infant, whether normal vaginal delivery or cesarean, when cesarean is done, the skin microbiota persists, the birth environment, and rarely genetic factors. So after infancy, the probiotics separate from the raw foods such as lactic acid, fermented foods like yogurt, cheese, and probiotic supplements alters the microbiota. So the factors affecting the intestinal microsystem, like it depends upon the antibiotics and other drug intakes, microbial infections, diet, particularly highly processed food or low fiber foods, infections like chronic diarrhea, stress, chlorinated water, radiation, etc. And the detoxification is not done nowadays. So what are the characteristics of effective probiotics? The microbes should be able to survive the passage through the digestive system, able to attach to the intestinal epithelia and colonize, and able to maintain a good viability, and should be able to utilize the nutrients and substrates in a normal diet. Should be non-pathogenic and non-toxic. It should be capable of exerting a beneficial effect on the host. The stability of the desired characteristics during processing, storage, and transportation. Except most of the probiotics, they need a cold chain to be maintained. Only very few companies maintain that. And of course, it has an anti-inflammatory, anti-mutagenic, and immunostimulatory functions. So what are the major indications? Number one is our inflammatory bowel disease, mainly Crohn's disease. So mainly Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis, inflammatory bowel disease, intestinal disturbances like gas, bloating, constipation, diarrhea, dysbiosis, etc. And another important thing is the irritable bowel syndrome. And other things like metabolic syndromes like diabetes, obesity, etc., lupus, HIV, rheumatoid arthritis, as well as post-radiation, and atopic, very commonly used nowadays. So the major microbiota used are lactobacillus acidophilus, Bifidobacterium bifida, as well as lactobacillus rhamnosus. So actually, bacteria can be used, fungus or like saccharomyces can be used, and even parasites like trichuris has been used in inflammatory bowel disease. So what are all the potential benefits of these probiotics? So they are used in lactose intolerance patients where lactose is converted easily to lactic acid, prevention of colon cancer through the heterocyclic amines, cholesterol lowering, as I've talked about ACE inhibitor some time back. Due to ACE inhibitor, like peptides are produced during fermentation by these probiotics. And immune modulating functions, and even in H. pylori infections, probiotics are used, particularly Saccharomyces has been used. And even during therapy for Helicobacter using a triple therapy, addition of probiotics is recommended. And diarrhea, it is used to treat various forms of gastroenteritis, particularly in children actually. And again, it can reduce inflammation by regulating the cytokine functions, improves the mineral absorption, and it prevents the harmful bacterial growth. And the main usage is in inflammatory irritable bowel syndrome as well as colitis. The most common theory is that the IBS is a disorder of the interaction between the brain and the GI tract, although there may be some other abnormalities in the gut flow or gut flora also. So this is in how they act actually for probiotics. By immunomodulation, it is used to treat inflammatory bowel disease, and by altering the microbiota composition, irritable bowel syndrome, and by metabolic effects like bile salt deconjugation, it's used to lower serum cholesterol also. And again, lactic hydrolysis by producing lactic acid improves the lactose intolerance. By metabolic effects, as I said about the amine conversion, it reduces the colon cancer formation also. So the resident bacteria within the human gut, they are considered to represent a crucial line of defense against colonization by potential pathogenic microorganisms. So dietary supplement, you give prebiotics and probiotics. Probiotics, as I said, they are microorganisms. What are prebiotics actually? Prebiotics are, already they are formed substances like fructose oligosaccharide, galactose oligosaccharide, inulin, lactoferrin, and the commonly used lactulose, what we are using for more than 50 years actually, it's a prebiotic. And the food we eat actually, garlic, onion, asparagus, tomato, and wheat, what we eat normally in our routine food intake and supplementary food, they contain all the prebiotics actually. And now we have prebiotics separately, probiotics separately, combined together, it's called as symbiotics. Now, again, along with the multivitamins also, it's available. So this is, for example, in an old patient actually taking antibiotics. The gut flora gets altered, it becomes a dysbiosis. So when somebody takes an antibiotic, the facultative anaerobes, Mucobacterium, Clostridia, and Eubacterium goes up. Whereas the bifidobacteria, what we supply as probiotic, they come down. So when there is a dysbiosis, we neutralize it by supplementing probiotics. So again, as I said, the dysbiosis, there is an intestinal imbalance where pathogenic microorganisms outnumber the beneficial bacterial species. So what happens is in the normal esophagus, there won't be much of microbacteria, whereas in the stomach, there will be about 2 to 3 colony-forming units per gram. As it comes down, it increases. From the stomach to the urinary, 10 to 10 power 3 to 4, jejunum 5 to 7, ileum 10 to power 7 to 10 power 8, and the colon 10 power 10 to 10 power 12, colony forming units per gram. So it is said on a weight for weight basis, the bacteria present in the body outnumbers the number of cells in the human body. So what are the major causes of dysbiosis? It can be due to a decreased immune function, poor diet, and particularly taking oral antibiotics. And oral contraceptives, it can alter the vaginal microflora. And of course, patient on corticosteroids, it can cause something like immunosuppressive. And again, persons of intestinal infections, motility problems, stress, etc. The common symptoms, again, in a dysbiosis, you can get abdomen pain, cramps, constipation, distension, etc. And bad breath, body odor, mainly in features of irritable bowel syndrome, leaky gut syndrome, etc. So as I said earlier, these are the common probiotics used, like lactobacillus, multiple species, streptococcus, bifidobacterium, saccharomyces, etc. So initially the trade name they used was VSL3. VSL3 means V for bifidobacterium, S for streptococcus, L for lactobacillus. The same combination now is present in almost all the probiotics used, like even in Guttredo, it contains all these things. Other species, the various subspecies of lactobacillus, bifidobacterium, these are the commonly used ones. So this I mentioned here, I have covered already. Again, this one also I covered already. So most of the studies, it has been done in pediatric children, in children actually. They can be used for lactose, for managing lactose intolerance, antibiotic associated diarrhea, decreasing constipation, and necrotizing enterocolitis commonly in children has been used. And again, for dental caries, infantile colic, and even in skin problems like atopy, eczema, etc., probiotic as a role. The proposed mechanism I have discussed earlier. Again, the common, all the headings are on the antibiotic associated diarrhea, because we have studies actually to show that they are useful. Antibiotic associated diarrhea in children, infectious diarrhea in children, chemotherapy associated diarrhea. In children, particularly with constipation, and the important one is a necrotizing enterocolitis. Okay. and even Indian studies we have. Okay, in network dressing and interpolates, again, it has been used. And many say it, the probiotics should not be used as a prophylactic purpose. So after using antibiotics, you can use it as a course. So the commonest organism is lactobacillus, rhamnosus, hereditary, etc. The dose differs with the capsule. But standard one is again 10 million organisms per dose is the commonest one, and many they require refrigeration because they survive between 4 to 28 degrees. So ideally cold chain can be maintained. So this one I can cover already. So take home points. So there is a good for regarding probiotics, there is good evidence for infectious area treatment, antibiotic associated area in treatment, and important is necrotizing enterocolitis in children. And there is promising evidence for preventing skin conditions like endophthalmitis, constipation for when there is a bowel movement disorder. And the commonest one used is a lactobacillus GG, and the combination products now, although not with synthesis, it's used actually. Because most of the preparations, they have all that combination, bifidobacterium, streptococcus as well as lactobacillus, and some have saccharomyces boulardii also, which is a yeast. And the side effects is very, very lesser. Only very, very few, 2%, they have a risk of bloating and gas. And there are not much of contraindications. Only two contraindications that they have mentioned books in. One is acute pancreatitis, they say it should not be used actually. The risk of sepsis is very high. Again, in immunocompromised individuals, suppose if you give, they can go in for a septicemia, endocarditis, and even death has been reported. So only these two contraindications, acute pancreatitis with SIRS, and severely immunocompromised individuals, you are not supposed to. Otherwise, you can use it.
How many days duration is pediatric?
Duration, they say up to 3 weeks, madam. Up to 2 to 3 weeks, it's enough, actually. But in those days, many of the antibiotics, they came along with the probiotics, actually. Now, it's not recommended as such. But following that, you can use it, actually.
Sir, the HIV patients, they complain of often motion.
So because in an immunocompromised individual, this bacteria can multiply. They can cause sepsis, endocarditis, and even death has been reported. And most of the patients with HIV, when they are start on HIRT, with antiretroviral drugs, they improve. And many times it's due to some viral diarrhea, like cytomegalovirus and all. Ideally, no need to, because these are basically live organisms, so we are not supposed to. No, no, other only one problem. Acute pancreatitis is in SIRS, so they say you don't give. Because in one study, out of 15 patients, there are 6 or 7 deaths actually. So only that is only contraindication mentioned in our patients.
Thank you. I thank all the members.